is Truth Frequency Radio.
No hate, no hype, no fear. Real people, real radio.
Broadcasting straight to you from a large spaceship, currently cruising the skies of beautiful British Columbia, Canada, looking for flat earth females. Rumor on the street is they go crazy for guys into alternate ways of perceiving our world. Might just be a rumor. Someone confirm that. Hello, everyone, and welcome to Strange World, where the truth is often stranger than fiction. I'm your host, Mark Sargent, the creator of Flat Earth Clues, which propose that all of us are living inside a Truman Show enclosed structure thousands of miles wide. Check it out at enclosedworld.com or just Google Flat Earth Clues. If you can't find it, well, you're trying to find the curvature of the Earth, and that's distracting you. You're never going to find it. For those of you listening to this on YouTube and want to hear the show live as it happens, please go to Truth Frequency Radio for the latest schedule. Currently, this show is on Tuesday nights at 7 Pacific, 10 Eastern. Hope you guys catch it live if you can. But if you can't, we'll try to get it up on YouTube for you. Phone number to call in tonight is 720-897-6111. That is 720-897-6111. Operators are standing by. And by that, I mean me, because I'm just going to bypass the switchboard. And your call is going to go straight to my phone line. I'm going to pick it up. We can talk. And while you guys are thinking about calling, we'll do some mailbag, and I also want to talk real briefly about the Jeffrey Grupp debate challenge. In fact, I'm going to bring it up every week, as long as he asks me to do it, which is Jeffrey Grupp, probably the biggest, largest, at least the largest head, I think, in Flat Earth, because he has a really, really big cranium, probably bigger than mine. He has decided that he is going to debate anyone relevant that's out there. So if you have a website that likes to debunk stuff, or if you have a YouTube channel that goes against Flat Earth and you want to pick a fight, by all means, Jeffrey is going to take all comers. Remember I said last week, he is the big surly guy in the back of the bar with a broken pool cue, just looking for someone to come at him. And I hope somebody does. I really, really do, because he's been looking for a while now, and it's tough to find people to debate against. Because, you know, a mainstream scientist is going to, you know, do you want to be the first mainstream scientist to go down in a big fiery ball of twisted metal against the Flat Earth movement? I'm sorry, the Flat Earth Awakening. That's what I'm trying to call it now. I know everyone's been saying Flat Earth Movement for more than a year, but I am trying to change it based on a listener's request, change it to Flat Earth Awakening because it seems more appropriate. And you know what? I agree. Also, before we get to the wonderful emails that I get every week, also any subject matter experts that want to talk about anything in regards to Flat Earth, prove or disprove, we've done 16 different guests so far over the period of, I don't know, 6 months or so, and cover just about everything, everybody from all the major United States military branches. You know what? Let's read them off. I like reading these things off because I have this list in front of me. United States Navy missile instructor, United States Air Force navigator, Marine Corps sniper instructor, Navy submarine chief, Army artillery radar operator, Australian intelligence officer, American flight instructor, industrial engineer specializing in valves and seals, career surveyor of over 32 years, international shipping expert, a corporate travel agent, an air traffic controller, United States Army Master Gunner, an aviation and ground training combat expert, a USDA surveyor, a 32nd degree Mason, and an etheric science researcher. Who will be the next person to come out and say, you know what, there's something wrong with this whole globe thing? And again, you know, this list that I rattled off here, it is part of the Subject Matter Expert series, also known on my YouTube channel as The Testimonial Shows. Excuse me, there's a playlist for that, and please check it out when you get a chance, because it's a lot of fun. I mean, it's long, you know, all those are, each one of those things I rattled off are about 2 hours. Sorry, drinking tea tonight. Talked a lot over the weekend. Hopefully my voice will hold out while I'm reading Mailbag. I think it will. And yeah, so please, you know, testimony shows, anyone who wants to come out and talk about this, I'm still looking for people from the aerospace industry, anybody involved in astrophysics, astronomy, ex-NASA, current NASA, anyone from Space Command, anybody who's worked at Jet Propulsion Laboratories or any of the space centers, you know, Kennedy or Houston. Please, by all means, you know, let me know for or against. I don't really care which side you're taking. Although every single person I've had on the show has been pro, and not a single person has said, I have not gotten an email saying, I want to come on your show and debunk Flat Earth, because you can't. Once you look in the box, you can't do anything anymore. You're stuck. Your Pandora's box is opened, and you start going down the rabbit hole, and forever will you be in it. You know, in fact, if I'm not mistaken, out of all, and think of this, you want a telltale sign, because lots of people, especially men, you know, their egos get in the way, a telltale sign of how convincing this thing really is, regardless of what exact shape or form this new world takes, please note that as of right now, only one person, I mean exactly one person, has gone into Flat Earth and then renounced it, and that was Tiger Dan 925, his YouTube channel name, anyway, I don't know his real name, out of Great Britain. He was in Flat Earth, he was in it for a while, he started to redraw the map, something happened, and then he turned against Flat Earth, and he didn't even turn against it completely. He got about halfway into a video series, he said, I'm going to do a 10-part series against Flat Earth. He got 5 parts in, and then he quit. And I mean quit, like, his YouTube channel's up, but he never made a single video after that. We've never seen his face on camera again. And he started out as a devout Christian YouTube maker. He just made videos really about chapter and verse, quoting scripture a lot. So, yeah, nobody else has come out against it, which, you know, that's 99.999% of the people that get into the Flat Earth, they stay in Flat Earth. It's like you're being inoculated against the globe, which I really shouldn't use too much, because that kind of goes down that whole vaccine path, and I'm not a big fan of vaccines. Anyway, while we are waiting for the phone calls to come in, and again, if you want to call in and talk to me live about anything, it doesn't even have to be Flat Earth. You can always, because I'm going to be, some of you know, I'm going to be doing another show on top of this one at my own website called marksargent.com. And we are going to be talking about things other than Flat Earth, not necessarily because I want to talk about things other than Flat Earth, but that it's a good bait to get people into it. So if people want to talk about, Roswell, you know, they want to get on and talk about Roswell, I'll talk about it. I will keep dovetailing it back to Flat Earth eventually. That's how you get people. I mean, look, everybody who's listening to this now started out in other conspiracies. And then for some reason or another, including me, got into the Flat Earth. And that's, you know, appears to be top of the food chain right now. So that's why we're going to do it. And we should have a lot of fun doing it as well. Okay, so real quick, one more time for the phone number, and then I'm going to read some emails. Number to call in direct is 720-897-6111. And the second I said that, somebody's calling in from, 845 area code. So it's prepping you, whoever you are, and we're going to pick you up. Add to group call. You are on live with Strange World.
Hey, Mark, it's Psycho Mark from New York.
Oh, man. Why are you always the first call?
I don't know, because I just want to make sure I get in.
Thanks, man. What's going on?
I don't know if you saw the picture of the brakes I sent you. I don't know if you caught that.
For
the 300.
Oh, yeah.
For the 300C.
Yeah.
Yeah, I put a set of upgraded brakes there.
Nice.
Awesome. The thing put you to the dash. It's awesome.
Right on. That's great.
Hey, I got one Flat Earth and then one UFO thing.
Sure.
I was trying to go, I understand the curvature. you know, 8 inches square per mile because it's a slope. It's a curve rather than a slope, which is a constant 8 inches per mile.
Yeah.
But I was listening to an older, and I hate to even bring it up, that Red Rhetoric kid.
Oh, man. He's like 17 years old, right?
Yeah, I know. I just wanted to understand because I didn't know what the hell he was talking about with the calculations and saying trigonometry and all, you know, and it's saying trigonometry. I didn't know.
No. It is simple stuff. It is okay. It's good you brought this up because a lot of people, which is why I never brought it up in the clues. I tried to avoid math at all possible because Americans, especially, I'm in there. I mean, I don't like math. I have to use it, but I'm not a big fan of it. It's not natural for me. I'm not a fish in water when it comes to math, but. There's two things. Yeah, if people get confused because when you're talking about the curvature of the Earth, some people say it's 8 inches per mile, and some people will say it's 8 inches per mile squared. In fact, Wiki, I think, had it erroneously put in there where they said it was 8 inches per mile. If it's eight inches per mile, what you get is like a staircase, meaning it's perfectly sloped, like the side of a pyramid. So when you go down a stairs, you're going, I don't know what it is, like 11 inches per stair out. That's right. So if it's 11 inches every stair, well, then it's just, you know, you could take a board. Everyone's done this. You could take a sled and slide down the stairs perfectly because it's a perfect slope.
Right.
But if you're doing 8 inches per mile squared, and again, don't anyone's listening to this, don't get glossed over. I'll make it real easy for you.
Right. That is based on the circumference of 24,000 miles.
Oh, don't even worry about the circumference.
I just want to understand that. Because
No. It's okay.
That would change, correct?
The
inches per mile, if it was smaller or larger?
Yeah, absolutely it would. It might be 7 inches, it might be 9 inches, depending on the radius. So the radius, if you just measure from one side to the other, not take a waistline shot of the whole globe, is just about 8,000 miles. And if at that point you condense it in half because you're at that point you're going over two hills, so it'd be 4,000 miles.
Sure.
And you shrink it all the way down, it's 8 inches per mile squared, which means it's 8 inches times every mile times itself. So if you're at 2 miles, it's 2 times 2 is 4 times 8 inches is 32 inches. That sounds okay. You know, that's 2 miles. 3 inches is 3 times 3, which is 9 times 8 is 72. So it jumps to 72. 4 times 4 is 16 times 8. And I can't remember what that is right at the top of my head. I can break up the calculator. But it gets worse and worse and worse. It has to, because eventually the curvature the hill gets steeper and steeper until it goes completely vertical and there's nothing below you. If it was a ball. And
I just wanted to confirm because that is their argument. We're using math, you're so confident with math proves reality. This is the measurement you're giving us. Why the hell can't I see it?
Yeah. And I know where he's going with this. He's stealing some of his stuff from the geodetic surveyor, the only professional that came out. Of course, the geodetic surveyor is about as bad as an astronomer because the geodetic surveyor bases every one of his assumptions on that the Earth is spherical, hence geodetic. And the geodetic surveyor came on and he was doing some intriguing things until he got to this point where he was talking about the Statue of Liberty. And he goes, yeah, I've heard about the whole 8 inches per mile squared, blah, blah, blah. He goes, fine, you're 60 miles out in the ocean and you can see the Statue of Liberty from 60 miles out. So what? You're doing it wrong. But he wouldn't explain what exactly everyone was doing wrong. It's like, what are you talking about? 60 miles, you shouldn't be able to see the Statue of Liberty, but you do. And he couldn't, you know, again, there was no way. He's never, ever going to come around because he's very lively.
I live here and I can see New York City from the Tappan Zee Bridge clearly.
Yeah.
On a clear night, perfect. You can get just the right angle down and you can see the skyline.
Yeah.
As you're crossing.
The curvature of the Earth is the easiest. And again, I didn't touch on it in the clues because when I started out doing this thing, I wasn't even convinced that the curvature was non-existent. But I put the challenge out to everybody. I said, look, anybody that takes a picture out their airplane window, because we hear it all the time, it's like, oh, I see it from the airplane. No, you don't. Take a picture, put it on your laptop, your tablet, or whatever it is. Put a straight edge up to it and tell me the curve's still there. And if the curve's still there, you email it to me and I will absolutely put it in my slideshow and I will make a video for you. And no one, and we're right. 15 months in and nobody has done it. And it's, yeah. Gotcha. So it's not there. Anyway.
I also heard there was some like Masonic calculation with 666 or some kind of crap where you could come up with the same measurement in feet or something. I heard it real quick on some video and I didn't get to see what it was. I listen a lot while I'm driving, so I don't watch.
That's all right. I don't know exactly what you're referring to. I can tell you, I've done two shows now, one on perceptions and one on this show, dealing directly with Masons. And I still do think at the very, very highest levels that the Masons knew, along with some of the other secret societies, what the Earth really looks like. But everybody from, the lower level generals all the way down to the foot soldiers, they don't know anything.
And it would make sense that they would pick a number that would have more than one meaning in calculation, sure. If that's what they're saying. Because if it's not a globe, who gives a crap what size we tell them what it is?
Yeah. Make up the numbers as you go along. And if you want to throw in some complex numbers that make your society more relevant or more, creepy, that, gets more members and makes them more mysterious, then sure, why not?
Yeah, definitely.
So what was your... go ahead.
The UFO thing.
Yeah.
I heard somebody mention this island called Starbucks Island somewhere in like the South Pacific.
Okay.
And they were Googling and saying, hey, look, there's a little thing on here that looks like it could be a crashed alien ship. To me, it looks like the front piece of a boat. I don't know.
Yeah.
It's hard to tell.
Yeah.
But I zoomed out and I was just goofing around and I found some other island and I was like, let me zoom in on that. And I sent you a couple pictures of it.
Yeah.
And it was cool. It was Maidens Island, I think it was called.
Maidens.
And there was a lake inside of the island and all these little pieces of land, and the one piece I called it Italy because it looks like the boot.
Yeah.
And I zoomed in and I swear to you, I showed it to my son, my wife, and they're like, you know what, it does look like there's something under the water moving.
Well, yeah,
and it looks like it's a disc and like a trail with the the silt under the water, like it just is whispering through.
Nice. Well, it wouldn't surprise me. I mean, I was a big UFO guy for years and years, and I still am. I don't think that they're not real just because of the flat Earth. I think the whole context has changed. But yeah, any craft, for those who don't know exactly, the whole propulsion system revolving a UFO, it appears to be tied to the unified field theory, the magical theory that Einstein either didn't deliberately give us, which I think it was probably the case, or he took it to his deathbed, said, oh no, I never figured it out. And I'm thinking, no, he was probably smart enough to realize that a unified field engine would be extremely dangerous. But what it does is, unified field engine is the formula that balances the equation between gravitational waves and electromagnetic waves, which means if you have a fuel source, and this is sort of Star Trek-y type stuff, if you have a fuel source that can create that balance, you can do all sorts of fun stuff. I mean, one, you have a force field that can protect whatever your craft is from anything, and it also makes it an all-in-one vehicle. So it can fly, it can go underwater, it can punch through things without, I would imagine, too much damage. And it has the ability to also do amazing velocities, sudden starts and stops, because the unified field also protects the occupant from G-forces. And it's a fascinating concept. And it would absolutely, the unified field engine would destroy our economy, the world economy, right away. Yeah. Because think about it, no cars, no planes, no submarines, no boats. It'd just be one vehicle. It would turn everything upside down. But would not surprise me. I've heard of wonderful stories of crafts going underneath the ocean. Now, they can't go as fast. So they can't do, from what I understand, because, it's dense. They can't do 5,000 miles an hour like they can in the air, but they can do several hundred miles an hour, which is amazingly quick for under the water.
Can't imagine that. Can't imagine any vehicle I could ever see.
Oh yeah, yeah, and the lots of boats, military and civilian, they've all reported it. So it's interesting stuff. So yeah, cool stuff.
Yeah, it is definitely crazy. I mean, I can't see there not being something, because I mean if we've been seeing stuff in the sky for a long time.
Oh, yeah. Yeah,
they're in here with us, you know. It's kind of like that horror movie where, like, you're like, it's in here with us.
Yeah, you know, there you go.
You know,
why would they try to make it all scary?
Yeah, I agree. Sure, that would make sense. Yeah. Hide there and crazy. And I was watching more fake X. So I love that crap. It's so comical.
Yep.
And I show it to my friend. He goes, "Oh yeah, that's real." And I'm like, "No, look at it." And he goes, "Oh no, that's CGI."
Yeah. Unfortunately, I don't believe anything now. Any mainstream report that is in the space section or is from the space section, but is big enough that it breaks out into the top five stories, I don't buy it. Not for a second.
Yeah. I've been listening to some of the UFO stuff, and I feel so bad for the guys who are, like, so convinced that we went to the moon.
Yeah.
And they're just hiding, you know, that there's something else there.
Yep.
And I just feel bad.
Yep. I hear you.
It doesn't make sense anymore.
I agree.
When you really look at it and back away from all the programming and just say, hey, I'm going to be a critical thinker, look at this, and try to be a detective, and what the hell makes sense?
Yeah.
And it makes sense. It just, it bums me because I still love my Star Wars. And, you know, want to go to Disney and go to the Star Wars thing. And, you know, I still love all that crap, but it's like, wow.
Yeah.
You know, it's
I hear you.
Yeah, amazing. Sorry.
No worries.
All right, cool.
Yeah.
I'll let you go. To talk to somebody else.
Okay.
Have a good night. All right. Keep sending you 300 stuff and weird UFO stuff.
All right. Thanks, man.
All righty. Later.
See ya. All right. Let's throw out the number there one more time. And I might actually get to my first mailbag thing. And it's actually a pretty good one. I want to read this one. So if you're calling right this second, you're going to have to hang out for a second. So the number is 720-897-6111. That is 720-897-6111. You can talk live. While we are waiting, this one comes in, and this has to do with a mixer, but it's an interesting one. You might like this. And it's kind of a shout out to anybody in the Northwest area. Hey, Mark, recently I disappointed myself by not going into the mixer at Arnie's in Edmonds because I was there. Yes, I had written the date in my day timer because I had seen the ads on YouTube and I am local, but I never emailed confirming I would be attending. I enjoyed the little videos advertising the event leading up to it, and so I knew you were supposed to RSVP, but I never did for some dumb reason. Anyway, on the evening of the mixer, I was there and standing outside the room that was holding the event, and I got shy and figured out I had not RSVP'd that I was probably going to be putting undue stress on the ones who had made reservations, so I turned and went home, having only stared into the room for a brief moment. Even the hostess tried to get me to go in, but I backed away quickly. Now you know part of the reason why I am bummed. I decided to reach out to you because there is more to the story. I am bummed because the people I didn't get to meet, and I was truly hoping to find some assistance in an experiment I want to do. The above attachments, and I'm not going to do the attachments, give detail to what I will explain here, and my hope is that with the networking I missed out on the evening can be made up via your connections. I have a friend, Christopher Stone, who has Puget Sound waterfront property in an incredibly unique position as revealed in the attachments. From his waterfront dock, you have the ability to see the lighthouse at Three Tree Point, 7.9 miles, the lighthouse at Alki, 16.8 miles, and the shores of Indianola, 28.8 miles. Each image attached gives a pictorial description of what I'm trying to do. I hope you see. I would like to find somebody with a high-power telescopic camera that would like to pursue this experiment with me. On a clear morning in Puget Sound, it can be crystal clear at times, but those days are rare, and so it'll take someone who, like me, lives close relatively to Christopher Stone's home. Can you help? I wish I would have met people that evening because I prepared these images for the direct purpose of networking at the mixer to find someone who would pursue this experiment with me. Anyway, I truly enjoy your part in exposing the truth. I like the practical common sense approach you take, so keep up the great work. Steve Wilkie. I'm going to give you all his contact information in case you're in the Northwest and you want to contact him because he wants to be contacted. So, Steve Wilkie. And that's Steve_Wilke, at msn.com. And his cell phone number is 206 5900. So 206-948-5900. Steve, he's in the Northwest area. If you want to do a flat earth experiment, please get a hold of him. I'll do one more quick one before the break. Hi, Mark. Someone should hold DeGrasse Tyson up to his statement. Please explain your public statement, oblate spheroid and pear-shaped earth tubby at the bottom, skinny at the top. You liar, Tyson. Where is your evidence? Wouldn't Europe be underwater, or the bulge at the equator would affect river flows, etc.? Tyson, explain your lie or quit your job. This is incompetence. Just a thought, Greg. Yeah, Greg, you're absolutely right. Neil deGrasse Tyson is not only the face of astronomy and astrophysics, but he's really the face of science. He's probably the best public speaker to come out of the nerd quadrant in 20 years. I mean, since Carl Sagan, really. And that's really why he has a job. That's really why you see him as much. He's an outstanding public speaker. He's got some comedic timing. He has good stage presence. He speaks well. He's everything that the media wants, and so they just keep pushing him out. Unfortunately, he has no backup. He has no understudy. I don't even know what would happen if somebody tried to replace him. I don't know who they get. Nobody would even know who he is. So anyway, I'm hoping that one day I'll get to meet Neil and have some discussions, either privately or publicly. We'll see. So real quick, throw out the phone number, 720-897-6111, 720-897-6111. And after the break, we'll take more calls. Oh, and emails.
Ricky Friday with the Woo Crew. Fridays on Truth Frequency Radio.
Welcome back to Strange World. I'm your host, Mark Sargent, and tonight is call-ins and mailbag, to where you can call in directly to me, 720-897-6111, or send me your emails. And if you send them right now, you're probably not getting on tonight's show, because I get a lot of emails. But I do try to read every one of them. I do try to listen to every voicemail on my normal phone, not this one. This one doesn't have voicemail, the one you're going to call into tonight. So let's get right to it. While I'm waiting for the calls, David writes, I'm new to all of this mind-blowing information, but have always had my doubts about what I was being taught as a kid. I wanted to say thank you for your courage to speak out about these things, because you are helping open people's eyes. Looking up at the night sky is starting to make a lot more sense to me from a flat earth perspective. It's a scary world we live in. To think about the time and resources needed to fuel the lies that most people call reality. So thanks again, and take care, David. Thank you, David. It's very nice. Brad writes, greetings, Mark. Refer to me as Brad in the Sultan Washington concept, please. I wrote to you last week about the firmament, the Nevada rocket, and the underwater oceans called cold seeps. I was watching a vid from Flatwater this weekend, and he was reading from the Thracians text or something of that nature. And it mentions something called a marine sponge or soft ice. Sounds like the same thing to me. Most interesting. Thanks, Brad. Yeah, maybe. I don't know. I don't know. I have a good friend who says that sometimes I don't actually respond to the emails. But some of the emails, I really don't beg a question. They're just kind of throwing out a statement there. They just want it read on air. So that friend in question, you know what I'm trying to say. This one says, please do not read my name. So no, that's the next one. This one is Justin from Romania. I just saw your documentary. God, I've always knew it's something more to this world. Something wouldn't add up. My name is Justin from Romania. I have so many questions. And he didn't put any questions yet. So the next one is actually nameless. Please do not read my name. And yes, if you're going to be emailing me, remember, if you don't want your name read, please let me know in the beginning of the email because I just skim the email. So if you put it at the very end after this long thing, after I've read your entire life story and said that you used to rob banks for a living, and then you say, oh yeah, by the way, don't read my name on air, you're going to get in trouble. And the phone calls come in. So this one's from the 909 area code. You're on Strange World.
Hey, Mark. This is Paul Amos calling from Pomona, California. How are you doing tonight?
I'm doing well. How about you?
I'm doing pretty good. Well, don't want to take up too much of your time. I know that you're live on air. I just
Sure.
wanted to give you a little quick feedback.
Yeah.
I started watching your clues about, the middle of 2015, about August, and I'm not gonna lie, when I first actually started listening to the clues, it was kind of actually pretty scary, not to lie. It was so like overwhelming. I had to like break the first rule of Fight Club. I had to actually talk about it. And it's actually what the funny part is, as much pushback as I got from all my friends and family, the more I would start coming in the room, they would always start bringing it up. Kind of like how you said, once you put the rock in the can, it's hard not to shake it out.
Yeah.
And kind of my question for you is, what do you think is the biggest fear to allow people to open up to the idea of it being flat? Because at the end of the day, like you said, we're still going to go to our jobs every day. You're still going to take care of wife and kids and live life.
Yeah.
But what do you think really causes that deep-rooted fear that is in the people that will entertain the idea but still won't actually look into it?
The biggest fear that I've seen so far, and I've talked to a lot of people about this so far, breaking my own rules, of course, which is the biggest fear is that they can't run away from it. Because of their conditioning, like yours and mine and everybody else's, we're all told the same thing. We just in different degrees. We go through the school system, we're taught about the globe. But with every other conspiracy that's out there, every single one, you can run away from it. You can turn away from it and you never have to deal with it again. So if you don't ever want to think about 9/11 or Sandy Hook or Boston bombing or JFK or Pearl Harbor or any of the major wars or anything like that, you don't have to look at them. Roswell, fine. Who's going to care, right? You can just put it out of your mind and it never ever comes up. But with this thing, it challenges the very ground you're walking on. And that worries people. I've seen way too many individuals that have kind of phrased the same thing, where kind of like what you were saying, it kind of gets scary. You get this claustrophobic feeling, like you kind of like a if you're into movies, that weird movie twist at the end, like an M. Night Shyamalan movie, where you're not seeing it coming, a plot twist. And it gives you that sinking feeling like, holy smokes, the last 2 hours of the movie, I've been thinking this, but it's actually completely different. Multiply that feeling you got in the movie by years, depending on how old you are. Say you're 40 years old. You all of a sudden are told, again, I don't want to steal from the Matrix too much, but remember that line that Morpheus said to Neo, where he says, we don't free after a certain age, we don't free certain minds after a certain age because they can't hack it. Kids can absorb stuff all they want. Why I quoted the movie, the M. Night Shyamalan movie, The Village. You can, if you raise a bunch of kids in a planetarium, you can tell them that's the real sky and they're going to believe you. But after a certain age, the concrete starts to harden and your beliefs start to harden. And so then, where do you go from there? So it really, yeah, it's you're literally turning people's worlds upside down, and some of them don't want to do it. They just don't want to face it. Because who knows? Maybe there's a lot of other problems in their life. My sister, a perfect example. She said, "Look, I've got bigger things to deal with right now." Even though that's not exactly true, they're more relevant to her. And so this was just one more thing, and which made, it makes it seem like it's a real thing, an actual physical thing. They just don't want to deal with. But what you're doing is fine. You put the idea in their head, and you just let it go. You don't. And by the way, why they're saying they're asking you questions is because behind the scenes they're elbowing each other in the rib, saying it's this guy, it's that guy that believes in flat Earth. And everyone, it's so intriguing that people naturally want to ask questions. It's fascinating.
Oh, yeah. Oh, believe me, trust me, this is now my first go-to. I mean, I've been on, a few dates recently,
And just to throw it out there for opening conversation, I started talking about the flat Earth. And just for all the guy listeners out there, you get some pretty positive results.
Oh, I bet. No, women. It's, and again, that's the other thing, which is why I really, really, you know, I don't trust my instincts as much as I trust like female intuition. And that is, there's a lot more women involved. I mean, I know the ratio isn't completely, you know, 50-50 or anything like that, but there's a lot of women that got that are into the whole flat Earth thing way more than the other stuff. And people take note of that. I mean, there is women can sniff out BS, and they, in this case, they're not sniffing it out. I mean, I don't see, and we'll take it one step further, I don't see a lot of women that are coming out and making anti-flat Earth videos. And you know, almost all of them they're out there making the videos, they're all pro. And I think there's something to be said about that, except for that crazy British woman who looks like she was doing a whole bunch of meth when she got on camera. But anyway, so yeah, that's cool. That's I love that point. Bring it up on dates. Oh my God, that's awesome.
All right, Mark, it was awesome talking to you. I've been listening to you for a long time. I'm always checking on your page to see if there's anything new.
Yeah.
Last thing before I let you go.
Yeah.
I left this comment a while back, but if you do, because you did say you're talking about redoing the Flat Earth clues.
Yeah.
Just to take a little shot at Neil deGrasse Tyson, yeah. I think you should reshoot the Flat Earth clues in that same type of setup that he did on that redoing of the cosmos.
Okay.
Where it's kind of showing all your Flat Earth slides, but having you just do the narration.
Nice.
You got a really good voice, and you know, it's a pleasure to listen to.
Thanks, man. Very much. It's appreciated.
All right. Well, you enjoy the rest of your night, and you know, take it easy.
All Thanks, right. Mark. Have a good one.
All right. Good night.
See ya. All right, back to the emails and calls. Of course, the number is 720-897-6111, and you can call in, and you're going to bypass the switchboard and just go straight to me. You will not be vetted, so please don't call in and call me all sorts of fun names, because I've heard them already, to be honest. Anonymous writes, I will keep this simple. I am now a flat earther. I watched your video over 8 months ago in late 2015. I never questioned the ball Earth, but everything in your videos made sense. Right on. James writes, if the Earth is spinning at 1,000 miles an hour and speeding through space over 60,000 miles an hour with even greater speeds than that, then if a rocket or satellite was launched into space, such as the Apollo mission, when it breached the Earth's atmosphere into the nothingness of space, wouldn't the Earth just continue to move away from said rocket or satellite at a rate that would leave the rocket or satellite 66,000 miles behind or away from in every hour? If the Earth was only spinning and not speeding through space, then I could see satellites in the Apollo missions being plausible. Then this is all caps. However, there is no way that any objects can be launched into space and not be left behind to never catch up. Good point. We've all, well, a lot of us have seen that graphic of the solar system corkscrewing its way through the universe like it was shot out of a shotgun. And yeah, you get these weird nether zones. So if you're going from planet to planet, shouldn't, you know, if there's no gravitational force holding you there, shouldn't you just be, you know, shouldn't those things just be pulling away from you pretty quick? And you could say, well, no, you know, how we're angling the rocket, we can actually compensate for them. I'm going, nah, you're not going to be able to compensate for a lot of that, because even our fastest rockets barely even break, what, 20,000 miles an hour? Something like that? Let's see. And he also writes a personal message, and I'm not going to read that part. Let's see. Karen writes, another woman, I've been listening to you and Rob Skiba talk about the Earth being flat for a year, and I'm very drawn to the theory, but frankly afraid to talk about it with friends and family. The globe has never really made sense to me, and I remember asking a teacher in early grade school why the oceans didn't spill off. It wasn't well received. Now, I'm wondering about the theories that the elite are in the process of making Mars ready for off-world living to remove themselves from potential Earth catastrophes. If we can't get through the Van Allen radiation belt or to go to the moon, how is Mars possible? Do you think there is anything to the theories about teleportation or jump rooms that Kev Baker has exposed with his guests William Whitecrow and Andrew D. Bisaggio from Project Pegasus? These are things I would like to understand and would appreciate hearing your opinion if you have time to give it. Thank you. Wishing you a blessed day. Karen. Yeah, I have a couple questions in here, so let's see what I can do here. is Mars possible? No, Mars is impossible because there's no, Mars is not what you think it is. It is not a planetary body you can land on. It's some sort of point of light that, yeah, you can see with a telescope and you can zoom in on it, but it's no different than if you're in a planetarium looking at Mars in there. In a planetarium, Mars looks pretty real. It looks like just like it does outside, but you can't land on that one either. So then you say, well, that one's not real and the one outside is. It's like, really, how do you know? Who's to say when you walk out of a planetarium that you're not stepping into a bigger planetarium? That's the whole point of this exercise, what I've been trying to get you guys for the last year, which is if we can build a planetarium, and we can build some pretty big ones if we wanted to, who's to say someone else couldn't build an even bigger one and put us in it? And you say, well, no, NASA's obviously done all these things to prove differently. It's like, yeah, but you keep using the word NASA. Can you do it without using the word NASA? Can you prove you live where you think you live without using the word NASA? And don't give me the whole, you know, or the European Space Agency or JAXA or Chinese. NASA was the one that started it. Everybody else blueprinted off them. So if NASA was fraudulent, then they're all fraudulent because you can't say that one of them's real and the others aren't. And do I think there's anything to the theories, teleportation or jump rooms? No, I do not. I may have at some point, you know, not publicly, of course, you know, back in the day, may have thought it was possible, but not now. If those jump rooms go anywhere, they go to other civilizations that are outside of this place, outside of this soundstage, this planetarium, this game, but not to faraway worlds, not things that are millions of miles away or billions of miles away. Not a chance. So thank you, Karen. Number again, before I continue on, 720-897-6111. And feel free. You don't have to have a good question. Just any question, really. If you're curious about anything, because when I get to do the Mark Sargent show, I'm going to be talking about all sorts of fun stuff. And you know, feel free, because I'm trying to kind of get ready for that. So feel free. There was I think it was Daniel Ott, if I'm not mistaken, one of the people that interviewed me last year, and he just opened up, I think, the last hour and just let people fly with the questions. Any conspiracy with no, everything's on the table. So if you want to, you have a question or anything about any other conspiracy, I'm willing to talk about. Of course, I'd love to talk about Flat Earth because it is top shelf, but the others used to be top shelf. So I, you know, they got a little tarnish on them now, but I'll still talk about them. Hi, Mark. I'm an independent researcher that has been dealing with the Flat Earth model for the last 5 years in regards to the Coriolis effect with bullets. It is the rifling spin of the projectile that creates the Coriolis effect. Think of a pitcher throwing a curveball. The ball will curve to the opposite side of the throwing hand, right-hand pitcher, and the ball will curve to the left. If that same pitcher is facing east, the ball will curve to the northeast. If that same pitcher is facing west, then the ball will curve to the southwest. The spin dictates the deviation off of the straight line in regards to the ball or the rifled bullet. The CE, we're using the same Coriolis effect as CE, has nothing to do with it whatsoever. The CE is just BS like all the other global science. With weather patterns, it is how the hot and cold air, water mixes and where and from and where they mix that creates the initial direction of spin. I am an U.S. Army light infantry combat vet, so I am very familiar with how rifling and bullets actually work. I do have other answers to the modeling that your community has been searching for. Contact me if you would like. Thanks, Brian A. Lambert. Brian, if you're listening, email me again because I may want to talk to you. And I think when I pasted this sucker in, I did not include your email address, so I apologize for that. But yeah, love to get U.S. Army light infantry combat vet to talk about more ballistics. I've done some ballistic shows, but I would like to do more. So, and one of our former experts just commented and says, yeah, he agrees with you. I'm not going to say who that is, though. Jeff writes, what's Jeff write? Let's see, just the melodrama show with everyone slapping Mark's hand like he, oh, this is about the mixer, like he did something wrong. Thank God for Mark is what I say. True friendship is getting past some things sometimes, even when they are seemingly not ideal in our minds. Mark offended no one. The envious attitudes out there against Mark are what is offensive. It is clear to me the two of you, that would be Orphan Red, are good people and good for Flat Earth. And I think taking an apologetic attitude is being condescending towards yourselves. Just my opinion, Jeff. Yeah, I understand that part, but at the same time, you know, you get enough people that want a piece of you, you know, sometimes you got to give them a token. just to get him to go away. Because if you stand your ground completely firm, I mean, look, I wasn't completely innocent in that whole thing. Nobody was completely innocent. I mean, you know, it looked like something. Nobody's going to say that nothing happened there. You know, something happened. Obviously, there was a tape. But everyone, of course, imagined the worst, and the people that imagined the worst things were the ones with the worst reactions. So, whatever. Simon writes, "Hey, Mark, I have spent the last 6 months looking into the flat earth theory and was on the edge of becoming a 100% believer when it was highlighted to me that the North Pole star Polaris cannot be seen in the southern hemisphere. Surely, if the earth was flat, it could be seen from anywhere on the earth's surface. The fact that it cannot does suggest the globe model. I am so far unable to find an answer for this issue that conforms with the flat earth theory and was hoping you could help. Many kind regards, Simon." And a lot of people saying, "Oh, we've heard this question already." Yeah, but people that are new to the show and the theory, they haven't heard this question already. And it's a good point because it's out there. It is one of those questions. And that is, Polaris in the north can't be seen in the south. So what could the explanation be? And I refer to the gaming thing. I'm going to be doing a gaming guest here pretty soon, the guy that designs games. I am a big gamer, as you know, and in the simulation world, because some people don't like using the word gaming because it sounds childish. It's like, you know what? I'm a lifelong gamer. So you want to grow up, that's fine. I don't think I'll ever grow up. But when it comes to the sky, in simulations, what we do is we base what happens in the sky on region. So depending on where you are, you can display different types of sky based on region, because you can only be in one place at one time. So if you're in the, you know, if you're looking on the AE map, if you're towards the north, you're towards the center of the map, you're going to be seeing the Polaris star system. And when you're out towards the outer edge, you're going to be seeing a different star system. It's like, let me give the simple one again. It's like if you're in a planetarium. Now, planetariums are known for really only having one display system that displays all this stuff. But if a planetarium was big enough, you'd need multiple display systems. Now, those display systems, you can show normal things, or you can, you know, or you can just show different things. Each system is self-contained, so if you wanted to do a belt of Orion in one place and another belt of Orion in another, people that are underneath these systems are both going to think they're looking at the very same belt of Orion, but they're not. They're looking at completely different projections of it. That's what we do in simulations now. It's a cheat, but it's a good cheat, and it works because everyone buys it. You know, it's like, oh, yeah, look at that. You know, they look in the sky and they see a certain moon or a certain star system, and everyone thinks they're looking at the same thing that everybody else is looking at, and they're not. It's tailored for the individual or the region. It's fascinating. So that's my answer for Simon and anybody else that's asking that question. Let's see here. DJ Grom. Oh, he's great. He's the guy that dresses up like a Ferengi with the false teeth and actually interviews somebody on his show. Just look him up if you get a chance. DJ Grom. Fascinating guy. Interview is tough to do because and tough to listen to. The only one is because he adds in music, that Captain Kirk music at the end, you know, and you don't hear it when you're talking to him, but he adds it in post, and so you get all stressed out when you're listening. I mean, if you're listening to me now, you should be fairly relaxed, but if you're listening to that and really tense fight music from a 60s series, science fiction series, it's probably not going to help you very much. So he writes, "Congratulations, Mark Sargent." And I'm not going to do a Ferengi accent. It would hurt my throat to try to do it. "I'm very proud that you started using your powers for personal pleasure instead of always sacrificing things to the great god of morality. It must be what a new parent feels like when their little one gets up and starts walking. Just so you know, given the chance, I totally would have done the same thing. The reason I am writing..." He's talking about the mixer, of course. "The reason I am writing you is that I have two comments to add to your arsenal of FE evidence." Hey, that's great. I didn't even know he was an FE guy. "One, cut underwater cables, which result in no internet. It is my understanding that the internet incorporates satellites to transfer data across the ocean. Internet protocol states that a packet will travel down the easiest and fastest route, least number of router hops, to reach its destination. If a route is blocked, it will seek an alternative route. That being said, if a cable is cut to an area, the IP should dictate the traffic would be rerouted up a satellite and then back down. When you hear stories about a cable being cut in the ocean and all internet access stops to a country connected to the continent of Europe, that tells me that they're not using satellites and the only connection is down that one ground-based underwater cable. 2.2, Dungeons and Dragons. Do you remember the following? The elemental planes of fire, earth, water, and air. How about the book, The Planes of Power, The Astral Plane? All of these are using the word plane and never really meant anything to me other than alternate dimension when I played the game as a kid. Now, though, it seems to be taking on a new meaning since the prime material plane was how they referred to our dimension reality. Just thought I'd share. I'm sure you have enough evidence already, but here's two more. And I didn't include them. Also, now that Jonathan is gone, if you want a new wingman lackey, I'd be willing to provide some comic relief for you and your broadcast. Just asking. Talk to you soon and have a good week. The summer's just starting. Don't let the haters get you down. DJ Grom. And I'm sorry, it's G-R-O-M. There's not two M's in that. Thank you, Grom. And if you're listening, honestly, I like your show. I really do, in the whole format, getting people to join the Star Trek MMO game, and you're actually doing it in Quark's Bar. I love that whole format. You singing, however, wow. I just don't know if I could deal with it. It's good, but for a Ferengi, I think. But I don't know. I have to think about it. Let's see. Do I have enough? Yeah, I got enough time. Mark with a C, M-A-R-C, writes, thank you for taking my call. Absolute pleased to speak with you. I'll send you – oh, this is the guy that called earlier. I'll send you a pic of my 300C and Monty SS. Good show. Keep it up. Sorry about Patricia. Didn't want to bring it up on the show. Well, I'm going to bring it up now because you wrote me. Didn't want to kill the vibe. Oh, and sorry for not saying hello to your guest. I've been listening to these shows, too. I like the lighter side of things, too. Humanist Story has an interesting way of looking at things. Isn't that the truth? Humanist Story – they always, I've enjoyed, cause I do, I don't do it every week with these guys, but I do, I try to do a show at least once a week with Humanist Story, half hour, 45 minutes. And anybody that wants to go up against flat earth, if you're a globalist, you think you got a case, I'll set it up. If you want to debate them, you got to have something though. You got to have a YouTube page or a website or something. You just can't be nobody. But if you know scientists, if you know anyone that's really, really passionate on the globalist side, I got a really big-brained guy that'll go after you. It's Jeffrey Grupp. If a bar was full of mental powers, people with big mental abilities, he'd be the toughest guy in the bar, in my opinion. He does a lot. He never stops thinking, and I love him. So please let me know. You can email me at msargent, S-A-R-G-E-N-T, 23@comcast.net, and I will set up the debate for you. So yeah, have fun with that. And of course, subject matter experts. We're looking for a lot of them. We've done 16 so far from all branches of the military, engineers, professionals of varying kinds all around the place. And I was going to say all around the world. I probably shouldn't even say all around. Doesn't really matter. You know what I'm talking about. We need more people. And if anyone doesn't know what I'm talking about, go to my playlist or just look up testimony shows or Flat Earth Experts, or just go type in Flat Earth Clues. You'll find my channel, or go to enclosedworld.com and you will find everything that you need to get you started down this path. While we're waiting for the phone call, let's get back to the emails. Hello, Mark. I trust you are well. This email has no other purpose than to wish you well in light of the recent nonsense that seems to have resulted from that video. It's a little tiring, as I'm sure you're aware, to see an apparent queue of self-appointed public figures who feel a need to publicly pronounce their opinions about your private life. I'm not quite sure where all this medieval morality has sprung from, and sincerely hope to see it end as quickly as it had appeared. I've finally gotten my butt into gear and have a few flatter things I hope to release in the next 10 days or so. If you're agreeable, it would be helpful to speak with you and get some idea of how I might get on the YouTube radar. I don't like calling people on the spur of the moment, so I suggest that if you see me online in Skype, you have a moment to share, you will Skype me and we can speak. In the meantime, keep well. I'm sure your supporters outnumber your detractors. Kind regards, Adam. And you're right, the supporters do outnumber them by a huge margin. As a matter of fact, out of the thousands of emails and thousands of phone calls that I get, less than 1% are hate. I mean, yeah, of course, I'm going to get a couple here and there. But they out, compared to the forums, if you're anonymous, you're just going to light up the forums and say horrible things. But calling me directly or emailing me directly, you're going to have to spoof an email account or do something funny with your phone. And nobody does it. That's because trolls are notoriously lazy. So that's a note to all trolls out there. You suck on a whole bunch of different levels. And most of the time, I just don't care what you think, because unless you make a YouTube video that can convince people of not listening to the Flat Earth Awakening, what good are you? If you want to stand there and just start swinging, like Red's rhetoric, they're fine. We'll go around your flanks as faster than anyone can hopefully, this thing isn't slowing down, and it's spreading in a way that you can't stop it. And if it hasn't stopped by now, and let me make this perfectly clear, the Flat Earth clues were released in February of last year. If someone would have challenged it in the first 3 months, maybe 6 months, no, not a chance. And once a year has gone by, if you haven't come up with something by now, you're never going to come up with it. There is no magic bullet for this thing. The only analogy I came up with, and it's sort of a horror movie thing, is Flat Earth is this big lumbering werewolf that's tearing through the countryside, and nobody's got a silver bullet that can bring this thing down. So they got regular bullets they can try, but it doesn't. It just shrugs them off and just keeps on going. So anyone thinks they can bring it down, by all means, let me know. I'd love to get. I still haven't even gotten an email from anybody that says, "Oh yeah, here's why Flat Earth is absolutely." I mean, they use some of the old arguments, but nobody's got anything new. Nothing irrefutable. Anyway, hello there. I am no one. Paradox. Funny. I have been raised Catholic from birth, and since day one on this planet, I have always questioned everything, and no one gave me straight answers. Always that it's just how it is, or the best one, it's God's plan. Well, I agree with the facts. The Earth is flat, and I didn't know until recently there was a manufactured dome sealing us in here. Why would he abbreviate manufactured MF? Which, oh, MF, I get it. It's not manufactured. That's close. Which makes me question even more, like, why? Is this someone's science project at school in some other life? Is this all just a dream? Is this a test to see who's smart enough to discover the truth when we get to go? Then we get to go home. I have never been more afraid in my entire life, and I just want to go home, wherever that may be. I cry daily, even now writing this. I have not read this. This is not good. If I've been lied to my entire life, then I don't want to be here anymore. I'm tired of this. Is there a God? Is there some evil spirit? Am I God? Am I evil? Do I forget everything I have learned and just go get a regular job, go to church, praise the false prophet, give away my money to the church and taxes, get back on the wagon of doom? And then a lot of expletives after that. I am scared. I do not know what to do or think. I am pulling at strings here to keep myself alive when pulling the trigger looks so much easier. Don't worry, there's no gun in my mouth, I promise. I'm just merely saying this is how I feel all the time. Any insight would be gratefully appreciated. Thank you. And I don't think I get a name on that one. But if you're listening right now, what I'd probably recommend is, if you haven't watched it again, or maybe you haven't watched it the first time, depending on what you looked at on the internet, which is why I made this clue. I kind of got away from directing people towards the clues and did a video called Creative Force, because a lot of people were saying that it was getting them down, that it was making them claustrophobic, that it was turning the universe into a one-room apartment, and it was too jarring. They didn't know what to do, kind of like Neo in the Matrix. And I was my big pep talk to people and saying, look, you're special. And it wasn't just lip service. I was saying, look, this place, yeah, it's smaller than you thought it was, but it was built specifically for you with great care, and you are in it. And take notice that your significance in it is really elevated because of this. So you're not this tiny speck of dust in the middle of nothing of space. You are a major player in whatever this is, be it a soundstage, be it a simulation, be it a game, be it an experiment. You are a major part of it. And yeah, of course it's going to be scary at first, but eventually that energy changes into something else, or at least it did for me, where it changed in this big optimism. And that is, think of all the bad things we've been doing to each other and how that would change if everyone realized where they actually were. So hang on there, man. And I hope you're listening to this, and hopefully, I don't know when that email came in. I don't date time stamp this little thing when I'm doing this. So hopefully, you're still hanging in, and to date, I don't think anyone has done anything rash in the name of Flat Earth, We haven't even seen anybody blow up a building or go gun a whole bunch of people down, because I do think, compared to all other conspiracies, this is the most positive thing going. This is the beginning of the new golden age. This has the potential to change humanity and give them the opportunity to be what they always were meant to be, a noble race that doesn't turn on each other immediately if they don't have a common threat. Which, you know, really, that's probably our weakest trait, in my opinion. So anyway, hang in there, man. Number to call, of course, is 720-897-6111. Mark from Kansas writes, was watching this week's episode of Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., air date May 10th. In the middle of it, the character General Talbot was ranting at one point. Instead of using the hugely common "why on God's green earth," he said, "why on God's crusted pie?" Huh, that's interesting. In case you mentioned this on air and some aren't visualizing the meaning of this, a pie is, of course, flat on top, circular with a rim surrounding the outside perimeter. Had to replay it a few times and just sit and laugh. Had to call my dad in to show him as well. He's the one that got me into FE, and he runs flatearthbible.com. Just wanted to throw it out there. Thanks for all you do and keep up the great work, Mark. Yeah, that's great, because I'm a big fan of sayings. I use some really old sayings out there. You know, like who uses like "fly in the ointment" anymore, and stuff that's way, way older than that. I will use them, and I know anyone that's a certain age or younger, they're gonna be like, "What are you talking about?" But yeah, God's green earth. We've all heard that one. Why on God's green earth? But God's crusted pie. Wow, that's I've never heard that one. And I've heard a lot of sayings. So if the writers built it, I think the writers pick up on stuff on the internet, because they scour the internet for what's hot and new and interesting, and they will build it into shows every week. And that's very, very interesting. This one just, you know, was aired May 10th, so really, really cool. Let's see, another Mark. I'm Mark from Canada, more specifically Belleville, Ontario, and I have been watching Strange World for some time now. Needless to say, you and many others are making a huge difference in the greater good. I commend your efforts to bring this deception to the plate. And one more thing, maybe start coming in with the fact, if not in uniform, you're considered a psychopath or a terrorist, but known as a national hero for killing to protect against imaginary threats. Thank you, by the way. I'm sorry I forgot to give you my name. That is... Oh. Hello, Mark. I'm from Canada. Oh, I'm sorry. His actual name is Keith Sherman. Hello, Mark. I know Canadians speak English, but sometimes their emails are not the greatest. Maybe it's the slang up there. I don't know. Canadian people. Who knows what they're thinking? Let's see here. This one's from Judson, J-U-D-S-O-N. Hey, Mark, I've been a fan for a short while. That sounds strange. Why? I start with Flat Earth. Why would that be strange? I first got turned towards FE after watching a comedy sketch by NASA channel. Oh, that would be Matt Boylan. Then watched your Clues videos, then found Patricia Steer's channel. This all within a few short weeks. I'm reaching out to you after attempting to reach out to some other flat earthers. I'm an ex-aerospace engineer and worked in a major DoD contractor. I supported classified programs. What's ironic, it seems like it's been easier for me to take the red pill than it's been to for fellow FE flat earthers to believe who I am. Crazy, huh? I think I read this one last week. Didn't I? That's weird. He must have sent this a second time. I actually tried to contact Justin. This was a guy that, if anyone knows, yeah, Justin, my name is Justin Maybe. He wanted to talk. He wanted to be a guest. And I'm pretty sure I read this. He was an aerospace guy. And he was bouncing back and forth about stuff and then never got back to me. So, no worries. We'll figure this one out eventually. Next one's from Justin, not Judson. Justin writes, question. I've been doing research about this, and what about the supposed planet of Mars, Venus? Do they not exist? As far as the satellite technology is supposed to be a hoax. Finally, this whole Admiral Byrd conspiracy is, well, is to say, interesting. I've stumbled upon these findings after hearing a friend speak of this. I will say that I've stood in the desert of Kuwait, and there was nothing but sand as far as I can see in 2003. One of the most amazing things I've seen. Anyway, thanks for putting info out there because I try to do my homework. What's fascinating about this theory is that I've heard an atheist say he believes in God because of this, which is astonishing in itself. Peace and blessings, Justin. Justin, if you're listening again, you know, if you, because that argument comes up. In fact, the debate I did with that guy a couple months ago, he was saying, well, if planets look like there's spheres, then we must be spheres. I was going, yeah, but planets in a planetarium look like spheres, but you're not in a sphere when you're in a planetarium. You're actually in a flat surface covered by a dome. So the argument is, once again, if you walk outside of a normal planetarium, who's to say you're not in a bigger planetarium? And you say, well, NASA told us. I was like, yeah, it's fine, but NASA is a military part of the United States government. Would they have reason to lie to you in any capacity? Yes, they would, if you gave it some thought. If they figured out that the world wasn't round after 500 years of science said it was, there would be a major upheaval academically, economically, religiously, just general spirituality. It would turn things upside down, and the powers that be do not like chaos when it can't be controlled. Now, they will do organized chaos from time to time. We've all seen it with wars. But a global, I use the word loosely here, global chaos would be tough to do. It would, you know, there's a chance that they may not be able to get their hand around it. And I just don't think they're going to do it. Phone call coming in from 810 area code. Let's pick it up. You're on the air with Strange World.
Hey.
Hey.
Let me mute my phone here.
Hey, what's going on? Hold on.
Hey, this is Dave in the Thumb. How's it going, Mark?
I can't complain. How about you?
Good, good. Hey, I called you last week. I'm the blind guy.
Oh, right.
Anyway, my brother was playing the Flat Earth Clues movie for me over the phone.
Oh, cool.
And, yeah, it was pretty cool. I didn't get to hear it all, but I still want to know if you could play it on the air. But I was just thinking,
Yeah. You
know, you're talking about a planetarium with a dome over the top of a flat surface, right?
Yeah.
What if there's a dome over the top of the bottom?
The top.
So there's a globe.
Oh, yeah. No, I know what you're talking about. Two halves of the same coin. I know.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. It'd be an efficient way to do it if you were doing a whole bunch of domes. Yeah, why waste it? Because you could control gravity from both sides, and you absolutely could do it.
Right. So we are on a globe, but it's actually just two halves of a flat, right?
Yeah. Yeah, that would do it.
I don't know. I'm kind of new to this, so I just thought about that after we talked last time, and I did send you an email, but I heard recently on another program that Nibiru or Nibiru or Planet X, Planet 7X, whatever you want to call it.
Yeah.
The red dwarf sun merged with our sun, and we have red sunsets and sunrises now, and the afternoon sun is blazing hot and blazingly bright. Have you noticed anything like that?
No, I haven't. That's the first I've heard of it. But for me, you know, because I was big into Nibiru in 2012 and then 2013, like it's 2016. And now that I'm into this whole thing with Flat Earth, if Nibiru decides to rear its ugly head, I'm not buying it. I'm just not. Whatever happens, whatever you see in the sky at this point forward, if some celestial event happens in the sky, and I don't care if it's a comet, an asteroid, a planet, a series of planets, or if the sky just turns red one night with weird orange sparkles, or if a bunch of spaceships show up, don't trust it. Do not take it at face value. Look at it and say, you know what? There's probably something else going on here. No different than if you were in a planetarium and all of a sudden somebody hit the wrong button and a laser Pink Floyd show showed up up above you. It's like you'd think it was weird, but it's like you'd accept it for what it was. So anyway,
I hear you, and I agree with you. I don't believe anything I see or hear anymore.
Hey,
I mean, if, it,
coming from the powers that shouldn't be.
I like that. That's good. Hey, if you're going to, by the way, if you're going to listen to it on the phone, don't listen on speakerphone. If he's got a little headset, you know, that plugs into his phone, listen to it on that. It's way clearer.
Okay.
So just
very cool. I'll do that.
All right.
Okay. And you're going to talk to Chris and Marie about
About putting it on the TFR. Yeah, you bet I am.
Perfect.
Okay.
All right. Have a great night, Mark. All right, keep up the good work.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye. All right. Let's go right back into emails, and we're going to say Lawrence writes. This now makes so much more sense now that we know all Southern Hemisphere flights go off the grid just after takeoff and why they had no idea where the plane was. Why is this not blowing up the internet, and why are the families of the passengers, why are they not screaming about this? Lawrence, because the mains, I can't even confirm that there are planes that are crashing, because if the planes aren't on the radar, you can make up anything you wanted. When it comes to the planes. And by the way, it's not just in the Southern Hemisphere. I know in the clues I talked about the Southern Hemisphere, but much later, I mean like 8-9 months later at least, I was looking on, in fact, I think it was on, if I'm not mistaken, with the flight instructor out of Iowa. And he was doing some research in the background while we were doing breaks and stuff. And he realized it was also in the Northern Hemisphere. Now, the routes aren't as exaggerated in the Northern Hemisphere. But what happens is, like a perfect example, a lot of Americans fly to Hawaii. But once you get off the coast of California or wherever you're leaving on the West Coast, that you're heading towards Hawaii, your plane will drop off. And that's very, very interesting. That means, you know, that confirms that the GPS system is absolutely not doing what as advertised. And of course, you know, some people are downplaying. It's like, no, GPS doesn't track flights. I'm just going, why wouldn't it? It's the most important thing you would want to track. I mean, tracking cars compared to, tracking airlines that are carrying defenseless passengers all over the place, plane drops in the ocean. You wouldn't care about where that plane went down. So I don't know, the search party would be a little more accurate, but that's just me. Beth writes, I'm watching one of your videos, and you said in the middle of the ice shelf in Antarctica is the outer rim. Forgive my ignorance. I'm still researching everything I find, but outer rim of the Earth or the dome? It would be the dome, by the way, Beth. I can't help but think of the Simpsons movie with the dome and the hole in the top. I'm not new to conspiracy or research, just researching flat Earth. Enjoying your channel, Beth. And yes, the Simpsons movie, great predictive programming on that, where they seal off the entire town of Springfield in a giant glass dome that nobody can get out of. And then all of a sudden everything changes. Everybody turns on each other. All the dynamics of the city change. Fascinating little take on the movie, especially since it took so long for the Simpsons to make a movie. And that was basically the whole plot. Just interesting, interesting stuff. Moving on. This one isn't too long. John writes, hi Mark, like your videos. I had an idea. All iPhones have a tiny gyroscope in them. I was wondering if maybe it was possible to build an app that would measure the Earth's curvature. One would assume if you turn your phone off, turn it back on, the gyroscope should fix to a position until it is powered off and then back on again. So have an app where you could lay your phone down on a flat surface to calibrate power cycle, get in your car and drive 100 or 200 miles, and then lay the phone back down on a flat surface and see if the gyroscope is still calibrated. Maybe the screen would show a bubble of air in water surrounded by a circle like some levels. Might work better in water since it's harder to argue water is not level. Not saying you have to drive a boat a few hundred miles, just do the initial calibration on something that is floating, a small piece of styrofoam, and take that same flotation device with you, I'm scrolling up, and use it to calculate the curvature of the Earth in the new location, which will be the same on a flat Earth. I initially was thinking about getting a real gyroscope for the experiment, but since iPhones are everywhere, a free app would be accessible to the masses and could wake up a lot of folks, which is my main objective. Get people to open their eyes and start thinking. A free tool test that is easy to use, the easier the better. Publish the source code on GitHub to reduce the critics. I am not an iPhone developer, so I can't do it myself, but would like to find someone, and was thinking if you like the idea, throw it out there as a challenge and see if you get any takers. Keep up the good work, John. And John, actually, I wouldn't worry too much about the app, because the simpler and more convincing one for me is taking just a simple $5 bubble level, putting it on your tray table on a plane. Some people, I think, have already done it and taken movies of it, and it didn't surprise me what the results were. When the plane, when a plane gets up to cruising altitude, eventually the plane will have to either nose down or pull up based on the curvature of the Earth, which is 8 inches per mile squared. And if you put the bubble level on your tray table and, you know, go forward and backwards, not side to side, that bubble should move every once in a while, should dip, or, you know, what should go backwards or forwards, and then the plane should compensate for it. And there's people that have already shown that it absolutely does not move, which we always suspected. When the plane gets up to cruising altitude, it is flying perfectly flat. And you're saying, well, so what if it's flying perfectly flat? Well, I'm going, well, it's perfectly flat, and you're flying over a curved surface, or curved surface, you're going to just keep increasing in altitude until finally, you know, you have to compensate. The plane cannot infinitely go up in altitude. You can't go. Commercial airliners rarely go above 40 or 50,000 feet, and that would be, you know, on a long flight, they would get way, way higher than that. So you have to compensate and then nose down if the Earth was a sphere, and it's not. So there you go. Number to call in, 720-897-6111. Operators are standing by, and by that I mean me and my mouse button. Johnny writes, hey, Mark, I've been watching Flat Earth videos for days now, and my life will never be the same. Just wanted to tell you, your videos are among the best. Clear, concise, well thought out. You're a star, sir. About me, haven't watched TV for 10 years. Take all media with a grain of salt. Don't trust politics of any sort. I keep close to me kind people and the sort of Christians who don't talk about the devil and people. I should be saying that with a southern accent. It would be much more convincing. Who are genuine psychics and don't use their gift for pay. I am an artist and I see around my design. There is a designer. I am one of the creations of this designer, which is words fail me. You're the word guy. Keep up the good work, Mark. Kind regards, Johnny Mulvey. It's a good name, Johnny Mulvey. Where are you from, Johnny? I'm guessing Texas. Somewhere in the Bible Belt. But I could be wrong. Who's next? Mario writes, thank you, Mark. What I'm looking for. And you know what? I was going to start this, but I can't because we're going to break. So, all right. Let's try and get back. It seems to me so strange. Check wallet for his name. In the muck, I think his zipper stuck.
The Rundown Live with Mike and Kristen, Monday through Thursday on Truth Frequency Radio.
Welcome back to Strange World, the last segment. I'm Mark Sargent, your host, and yes, Brian Burden, subject matter expert. That was Joe Jackson stepping out from his album Night and Day. So we're going to take a few more phone calls, read a few more emails. I'm not going to be able to get through them all, unfortunately. I mean, you guys write some really, really great stuff, and I try to read as many as I can, and I'm sorry I don't actually have time to email your responses and read them at the same time. So hopefully you're listening to the show. Number to call in, of course, 720-897-6111. And let's just get right back to it. Mario writes, what I'm looking for is a peer review studies on how it was decided that the Earth came to be reclassified as a sphere. When did this officially take shape? No pun intended. The concept itself taking shape that gave rise to the planet taking shape from plane to sphere. What conventions that this fact was officially declared and what papers were written on it? My guess is the turn of the 19th century, entering the 20th. Because they quit publishing flat earth maps encircled with ice. The Mercator was its replacement. Ah, good point. And we get a phone call from 763 area code. So if you're listening, I'm going to pick you up. You're on Strange World.
Hey, Mark.
Hey.
This is Jason. I've talked to you before. You called me back on some things before even.
Oh, cool.
Okay.
What's going on?
Okay, I'm on air actually right now.
Yeah, did you not want to be on the air?
No, that's fine. First funny story, I walk into the store today. It's a little mom and pop kind of deal, and they're playing your theme song. I'm just thinking, I wonder if they know.
Oh, from Graveyard.
The one that just played right when you came back.
Oh, Joe Jackson. Yeah, that gets played at just about every grocery store that's out there. Yeah.
Where you got the idea, right?
No. I'm old enough that if you know my stuff, that I actually, that was one of the first, that was one of the early when MTV was new, that was one of their first videos, and that's what kind of hooked me on MTV. I was going, wow. I mean, it seems like a simple video today, but it was such a great storytelling medium that I was hooked. So that was my introduction to Joe Jackson. So anyway, go on.
Okay, so two of the interviews that you did really caught my interest. One was with the guy that did the NORAD thing.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, he's talking about being up. I think he's talking about being up in Duluth, and I'm actually in that area, so it kind of hit home.
Yeah.
And seeing things down, I think he's seeing things down in Minneapolis or whatever.
Yeah.
That's a long drive, by the way. If anyone doesn't know, that's a long drive.
Up in Duluth, up there near the Iron Range, yeah.
yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
He's seeing that stuff hundreds of miles away through the microwave, mm-hmm. radar's microwave. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm going back thinking about this, and I'm thinking about what Sean McCrary is talking about, seeing things in the infrared spectrum.
Yeah.
So looking at that and then looking at what you see these pictures of, like, Chicago, and you can see it, and it's way further than you're supposed to see it.
Yeah.
And you're seeing it in the visible spectrum.
Yeah.
And there's other ones. There's some guy online that's got a – I think it's Oahu in Hawaii, seen it like 90 miles away.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, the whole, you can see the whole island. Yeah, it's amazing.
So yesterday I'm sitting at home, I'm off work. I'm trying to figure this out. How come I'm seeing some of these pictures, like the ones with Seattle, where you can see the buildings, but they do appear to be sunken, but they're not tilting or anything like that. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, I do.
Okay. Here's what I'm thinking is actually going on. This is a theory. For anyone's listening, it's not a fact. Check it out, though. See what you can figure out. Take it further. Anyone that's ever shot a gun knows that bullet leaves the gun, and it's on a trajectory, slowly arcing towards the ground. Mm-hmm. Now, when you send light through a prism, or it's being refracted, it's slowly going down. But go and take a look at what happens when you send infrared through a prism. It's a longer wave. It's at a higher frequency, but it's a longer wave. Mm-hmm. I'm pretty sure that's correct. And it's impacted far less. And you just think about microwave. That's What I'm getting at is, the longer the wave, the less it's being impacted by atmospheric things. So what I'm thinking is, it's flat. It's freaking flat. And people are going off the visible spectrum, but now that we have these tools, the science hasn't caught up. The textbooks have not caught up to what's actually happening, because they were basing everything off of visible spectrum back in the past, without having optics or whatever, even in the visible spectrum that were, you know, superb. You weren't able to see further. Now we know, using optics, you can see these things further away as soon as they disappear with your actual eyesight.
Sure.
And crank it over to the infrared, you're seeing further. And when you lose that, well, we use radar. And you're seeing stuff on the ground hundreds of miles away.
Good point.
I think it's flat, and people are being letting their eyes deceive them is really what's going on. I just wanted to share that with you.
No, thanks.
It might solve a problem in your mind. There's whatever someone out there that's saying, how come these buildings appear sunk, but I'm seeing them further than I can?
Yeah.
Because that light's getting distorted in some way and hitting the ground. But infrared and microwave and all that, it's not being hit as hard with that atmospheric distortion. So
interesting. Well, yeah. No, thank you. Thank you again.
I think that solves a lot of the problems people are having with this.
That's great. That's awesome, man.
So I'll let you get back to your show, and I'll turn it on.
Thanks, man.
All right.
Talk to you soon.
Have a good night, Mike.
Bye-bye.
All right, see you, Mike.
Yep.
Bye.
Moving on. If anyone wants to call in the last segment, it's 720-897-6111. And where did I leave off? They quit publishing Flat Earth maps, circled the ice, and Mercator was a replacement. Also noted in my last correspondence where I used the phrase near non-gravitational environment. That's because the ISS falls in and out of non-gravitational or floating space. NASA even admits to this. This is what the vomit rockets do. Actually, the vomit comet airplanes for training astronauts. The further you go from Earth's plane, the more of a gravitational decrease occurs. Flipping high-altitude planes induces this effect. Stronger on the ISS, further away. NASA does not recognize pure non-gravity and they have admitted it. Any object that floats between the moon and the Earth is proportionally affected by both masses. I still cannot find that one YouTube where they make water act like it's in Earth's gravity on the ISS. However, I just recently, since our last correspondence, looked at some of the other water experiments and have to say blood is in the 90% range of composed 90% of composed water. Yes, I guess we can speculate what happens in the astronauts' heart, arteries, and veins. Unless the circulatory system's surface tension and the heart induces a vacuum effect that overrides this, imagine mini spheres in the heart chambers. Good point. What is the effect on the cardiovascular system if in zero gravity, the overall effect? It's interesting. We know about digestive impacts, but yeah, it's good. The next one, I'm going to read it, even though it's going to be really tough to pronounce some of this stuff. Shalom, Mr. Mark Sargent. There's a good intro. Indeed, I am a son of Y-Israel and fervently believe in faith in that which I read in the Torah, well, you know what, I'm just going to use the English version. The rules and the writings are explicitly the truth. I doubt not that which we were created by our Creator by his righteous arm, only begotten Son, was indeed flat and stationary and set on foundations to the extent that the big hand sun and the small hand moon measure time in perfection as they rotate in perfect symmetry, originally each 30 and 360 days above our flat and stationary Earth. I have just returned from Europe to my home country, the Bahamas, seated beside a barrister. To wit, try as I could with all of my legal learned prowess, he could not and would not accept certain things. One, of the indefensible argument by potential defendants, NASA, that the Earth was ever a globe. Two, of his law practice in the UK representing me as a plaintiff in a tort claim for billions under exemplary, wow, that's a tough one, and punitive damages for the children, past, present, and future, who are subjected to knowing and willful fraudulent misrepresentation by the institutions at large. Moreover, I am serious considering to locate a highly skilled mechanical engineer to work with me to design an operating device that replicates our flat and stationary terrestrial Earth, complete with its inherent time clock. Interested, Derek G. Turner. Yeah, I'll help out in any way I can for that. I don't know if you're going to be able to find a mechanical engineer that's going to be able to come up with something on his own. There's a couple that are out there that are doing several things, but I don't know about that. I am interested, so send me another email and you know, pitch me more details of your idea. Next one, God made it. That's the opening line. That's what the Bible says, and you have to admit he is the only one who could have. A flat Earth with an indestructible dome pretty much destroys so-called modern astronomy's heliocentric Big Bang and so-called natural history's macroevolution. Once those two ideas are dead, the demise of our current corrupt system is not far behind. The sooner the better, as far as I'm concerned. I'm enjoying your site, Lou. Thanks, Lou. It's awesome. See, that's another one. I don't have to respond to all of them. Because there's some, they're just statements. This one is by, he sent me a second email. This is the second one by Lou. You know what? Nah, let's go to the next one. How many has Lou written here? I'm trying to find more that aren't written by Lou. Lou sent me like three in a row. And I'm in the last section. I got to give other people a chance. Hi, Mark. I'm a huge fan of yours and became a Flat Earther believer last October. I watched Flat Earth Clues, studied Rob Skiba's Testing the Globe website, and senior podcasts. That being said, I have been in the Flat Earth argument on the letsrun.com website in the main forum section, look for "Are Flat Earthers a Real Thing?" It has generated almost 1,000 replies. The participants on this thread are, for the most part, college-educated and bring some strong globe arguments. I am having trouble refuting the satellite arguments. I have cut and pasted the satellite believer's response and could use your help to counter his points. See below. Here's your standard satellite stuff. If satellites in space don't exist, I wonder what I've been doing the last 28 years of my career. It's been relatively lucrative and exciting hoax for me. I worked on a project that sent a satellite to Venus and have seen the pictures coming back. I'd helped develop systems to measure the distance of satellites in transfer orbit and geo orbit using waves traveling at the speed of light and the pointing position of parabolic full motion tracking antennas. I've pointed direct-to-home antennas for friends who have struggled with offset parabolic antennas, aiming them not at the ground-based microwave tower, but up in the sky, where I knew a satellite to be emitting much higher frequencies. Tiny pointing errors resulted in a complete loss of signals across the whole spectrum, very visible in the scope I was using. I've seen Indonesian parabolic home antennas always pointing straight up. I've seen a Swedish antenna point at geosatellites, and it goes on and on and on. You want pictures of satellites in space on clear nights, you can see LEO objects with a naked eye. Pictures are not hard to find or take yourself if you don't trust the internet. They do not all come from NASA. You can Google images with keywords like satellite viewed from Earth. Dave, yeah, your friend's in trouble already if he's starting to think about this stuff. His point, please, by all means, look up satellites in space and find me an image that isn't fabricated. There should be thousands and thousands of satellites up there, and they should be taking pictures of each other, a lot of them. Where are they? You tell me where they are. I'm not saying there isn't something up there, but I don't think they're us. I went up, you know, for years I looked up there with night vision, and there were some things that I would have initially thought, like everybody else, oh, that's got to be a satellite, because that's what we're told. You got to remember, who told you there were satellites up there in the first place? The same guys that told you they went to the moon? The Americans? Those guys? And, it's easier for me to give the perspective from outside of our country, because outside of our country, not as many people believe what the Americans say is true, and they're not really that surprised. And it's like, oh, the Americans faking the moon mission? Wouldn't surprise me. So, next one is, Mark, I've just come across your clues while browsing YouTube, quite literally over the past couple of days. In your opinion, it is possible this may have something to do with a debacle that was Malaysia Airlines flight MH370 back in March of 2014. I don't remember the date either. Secondly, I know I haven't investigated enough, but does the model of the worldview you suggest have an equator? Does the flat model sit on an axis of any sort? Not the same sort of – I'm going to answer these in order. He doesn't have that many. Not an equator like you would know. The equator would be the middle ring. So the equal distance from the center of the dinner plate to the outer edge of the dinner plate, that would be the equator. Just take a look at the AE map, the azimuthal equidistant map. You'll see it. The equator is in the same place. It's just that it's not on a sphere. It's on a – very much David. David sent me – I'm sorry. That wasn't Phil. That was David. And David sent me some pictures that I think I included some of them in my slideshow, which you, if you're watching YouTube, you're probably catching some of that. Last chance, last 7 minutes, if you want to call me and talk about anything, 720-897-6111, and you'll go straight through to me. Phil writes a short one, actually. Phil writes, just watched your Flat Earth presentation. Good job, nice and concise. Rob Skiba has some good stuff on this too. Many thanks and keep up the good work. God bless. Phil from England. It's amazing how things tend to run the way they should be, because I get a lot of people to say, wow, have you seen Rob Skiba's work? I think you'd really like him. And yeah, I've been on Rob's show like 3 or 4 times. He's been on my show. We're on the same network. We talk to each other every once in a while. And yeah, Rob and I are on the same page. This one is, hello, Mark. I've gone through most of your material and started out as a skeptic. Not anymore. I am a devout Christian, and this just strengthened my faith. I have seen many YouTube videos, but I'm looking for links that maybe you know about that others don't, which could prove once and for all. I appreciate all your work. When I started, I was skeptical, but I was wondering why I was put on this path. Then I realized why. The Lord put in me a love for the truth, no matter where it might lead me. It has placed me on a path where the Lord has told me that he wants me to come out of the world. He was asked when he would return, the very first word Christ said was, "Take heed that no man deceive you." Now, that verse has new meaning to me. I am on a crusade of discovery. Please, if you have great links that could help, please forward them to me. Thanks for all the great work. Regards. And that's another one from David. I don't know if it's the same David. And yeah, if you want links, I usually refer people, what I usually cut and paste is the Flat Earth short list, which is a whole bunch of, it's like 20-something videos, and I update them from time to time, where different people in the Flat Earth community, not necessarily my, I've got like one in there, I think one, maybe two, I can't remember as of today, but the rest are all other people, and you know, everyone from, you know, hardcore people like Jaronism, all the way to an 8-year-old girl who only made one Flat Earth video, in fact, she made a Flat Earth video on her laptop, she's 8, that's amazing. Paul Allen, Paul Ian Leoncini writes, "I believe the world is flat. I agree that there are many things unknown and known for some innately. Most specifically, I believe your word. Thank you and keep up the good work. Sincerely, Paul." Jason writes, "Mike," I get that all the time. "My name's not Mike, it's Mark. My mom actually, from what I understand, was going to call me Mike all the way up until the day I was born, and then she changed it to Mark, which I think actually rings a little better. I mean, Mike Sargent isn't bad, but I think Mark Sargent's better. So, Mike, according to my understanding of the Flat Earth model, Antarctica is 360 degree ice barrier surrounding the ocean, which surrounds our land masses. If this is the case, we should be able to reach Antarctica by sailing or flying along any radial vector. It seems that the only portion of Antarctica that has been shut down is near South America. Please walk me through this portion of your theory. This would seem to be a great opportunity to prove or disprove the model. Jason." Yeah, if it wasn't for the Antarctic Defense Force and the multinational Navy, and you get to approve your flight plan through different countries, you know, it's nobody owns Antarctica. It's apparently split up by a whole bunch of different company or countries, and it's everything. You try, by all means, try to book something and let me know how it goes, because no one has even been able to get close, not civilian wise. I'm sorry, civilian. Sorry, strike that, reverse it. Civilian, what I mean is, you can go down there on the outer edge and you can get pictures taken with penguins. And if you spend enough money, they will take you to what they say is the South Pole. Companies cannot go down there at all. You can't do any commercial work down there, which is just amazing considering we're all based on money and greed and power. But anyone who's been listening to the show knows that already. 2 minutes left. And let's see if I can find a good one real quick here. Let's see. "Hi, Mark. I've been watching your YouTube videos and have wanted to ask you if you have any advice on how people like myself could help start making people more aware of the reality of our world. I wholeheartedly believe in the Flat Earth model, and the funny thing is I remember having questions pertaining to it all back when I was a child, like about the flight routes or why we don't feel the Earth rotating, etc. Anyway, I want to help if I can, because I know for many people the transition from believing in our globe to believing in Flat Earth is not so easy as it was for me." Email is Carolyn Trevino. Thank you, Carolyn. And yeah, if you're listening to this right now, the easiest way is to just put the bug in people's ears. You don't have to convince them. In fact, you're not going to convince them. That's what I'm telling them. It's like, look, it may have taken you 3-4 days to go down this path. And then you wonder why, when you're sitting across from your friend and you're talking 15 minutes, an hour, even 2 hours, you can't convince them, and it's frustrating. That's because you forgot how long it took you. Apparently, when a lot of people have their aha moment, they forget all the heartache and the mental somersaults they had to go through to get to that point. So convincing other people, no, don't try to convince them. Just put the bug in their ear. Say, look, how do you know? Or come at them sideways and say, listen to what these crazy people on the internet are talking about. Don't go at it and say, here's why I'm going to convince. I know you're excited. It's like, no, I want to convince you this. I want to talk to people about this, which is great. Just put the bug in their ear and let them go and let them deal with it on their own, because some people take longer than others. So with that, we're going to wrap up another show. I think that was a good one to end on. Thank you. Thank you for everyone that called in. Thank you for all the emails. I know I didn't get to a little less than half. I still have to read. Maybe I'll save those for next time. Remember, 10 commandments are great. You probably haven't memorized any. I really follow one rule, which is treat others better than you treat yourself. Next week, don't know what we're going to do next week. of course, you know, we're here on TFR every Tuesday night. And I've got a new network showing up real soon, marksargent.com. Check it out. We're already starting to build stuff. And that'll be a lot of fun. Still doing more YouTube videos. So, you know, appreciate everybody that's been supporting this thing so far. And I appreciate all the great comments and suggestions. So with that, we should have music like queuing up like right now. And there we go. How's that for working out? See you next time.
Geocentric Earth? Nice. I know all there is to know about the crying.
Call me.